JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for July the 28th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded mixed against the other G10 currencies on Monday and during the Asian morning Tuesday. It gained against CHF, NOK and NZD in that order, while it underperformed versus SEK, the euro and the Canadian dollar. The greenback was found virtually unchanged against the pound, the Aussie and the Japanese yen. Now, the weakening of the Swiss franc suggests that markets traded in a risk-on fashion. However, the weakening of the risk-linked Kiwi and the fact that the greenback failed to capitalize against the yen point otherwise. Thus, in order to clear things up with regards to the broader market sentiment, we prefer to turn our gaze to the equity world. Here, most of the major EU indices ended their session in negative waters, with the exception being the German DAX, which closed virtually unchanged. Nonetheless, sentiment took a 118-degree spin during the US session, with all three of Wall Street's main indices gaining on average 0.95%. The somewhat sanguine investor morale rolled over into the Asian session today as well. Although Japan's Nikkei slid 0.31%, China's Shanghai Composite and Hong Kong's Hang Seng gained 0.35% and 0.48% respectively. European markets traded in the red, mainly dragged by travel stocks after Britain imposed a two-week quarantine on travelers returning from Spain following the surge in coronavirus infections. On top of that, Ireland's Ryanair cut its annual passenger target by a quarter and warned that a second wave of infections could bring that number even lower. Lufthansa and Air France slid as well after the UK government said that it is watching closely the virus situation in both Germany and France. However, the picture was totally different during the US session, with investors betting on some of the most high-profile stocks ahead of their earnings reports. Apple, Amazon, Facebook and Alphabet, which are scheduled to publish their earnings this week, were among the top boosters, with Netflix and Microsoft also rising. It seems that market participants took the opportunity to jump back into those stocks after the latest corrective retreat, enhancing our view that the heat and tensions between the US and China, combined with the acceleration in global infections, are just resulting in deep downside corrections for now. Reports that Moderna Inc.'s virus vaccine may be ready for distribution by year-end may have also fueled the rebound in equity world, which dragged into the Asian session today. Now, moving ahead, investors are likely to pay extra attention to the FOMC decision due to be announced tomorrow, looking for clues as to how ready officials are to act again if the situation worsens. They may also be eager to find out whether the US Congress will reach consensus on a new coronavirus aid bill. Yesterday, the Republicans raced to complete details on their $1 trillion USD proposal, which is likely to include a reduction in emergency unemployment benefits from $600 to $200. That said, the proposal would need to be negotiated with Democrats, who see it as not sufficient support. Their proposal is for a $3 trillion US dollars plan. In our view, for equities to continue yesterday's rebound, a common ground should be found before Friday, when the enhanced unemployment benefits expire, and the agreed plan has to be as close as possible to Democrats' proposal. anything near the 1 trillion or even lower may come as a disappointment. This plan is not considered insufficient only by Democrats, but also by many market participants. Now, as for tonight, apart from headlines surrounding the broader market sentiment, Aussie traders may also pay attention to Australia's CPIs for the second quarter. The headline CPI rate is forecast to have fallen into negative waters to minus 0.4% year over year from plus 2.2%, while the trimmed mean rate is anticipated to have declined to 1.4% year over year from 1.8%. At its latest meeting, the RBA kept the targets for its cash rate and the yield on three-year government bonds unchanged at 0.25%, adding that they remain prepared to scale up bond purchases again if deemed necessary. Officials noted that the worst on the global economic contraction may have now passed, but still the outlook remains uncertain and the recovery is expected to be bumpy and dependent upon containment of the coronavirus. With all that in mind, and also considering the newly adopted lockdown measures in the state of Victoria, a deflationary CPI print may raise speculation that the RBA may indeed consider scaling up again its QE purchases at some point soon. This could prove negative for the Aussie, but we don't expect it to prove so determinant with regards to its broader trend. We believe that the risk-linked currency will stay mainly driven by developments surrounding the broader investor morale. If the US Congress agrees on a decent stimulus package, the currency is likely to get benefited, while the opposite may be true if there is a disappointment. Now, in case sentiment remains supported, we prefer to exploit any potential rebound in the Aussie against the safe havens, which tend to come under selling interest during periods of market optimism, like the US dollar and the Japanese yen. Now, as for today's events, the only releases on the calendar worth mentioning are the US Conference Board Consumer Confidence Index for July and the American Petroleum Institute weekly report on crude oil inventories. The CPI index is anticipated to have declined to 94.5 from 98.1, while, as it is always the case, no forecast is available for the American Petroleum Institute report. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the Weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.